Thank you to Brilliant.org for supporting PBS. What if every single black hole that formed in our universe sparked the Big Bang of a new universe? Cosmological natural selection proposes exactly this. But even better, it claims to be able to test the hypothesis. Physicists have been struggling for some time to figure out why our universe is so comfy. Why, for example, are the fundamental constants, like the mass of the electron or the strength of the forces, just right for the emergence of life? Tweak them too much and life, stars, galaxies, the universe as we know it wouldn't exist. In recent episodes, we explored one possible explanation for this, the Anthropic Principle, and the idea of the multiverse. If there are countless universes with different fundamental constants, then it's not surprising that a few exist with the right numbers for life, and certainly not surprising that we find ourselves in one of those good ones. But if you don't like the Anthropic Principle, and many scientists don't, then rest assured, there's an alternative. You only need to accept two things: that our universe formed inside a black hole, and that universes can evolve. Our universe appears, in some sense, designed. It has finely tuned parameters that seem deliberately set for a particular outcome, life. There's another example in nature where the illusion of design has a perfectly natural explanation, and that's life itself. We know that the fantastic complexity of living organisms is an inevitable consequence of evolution by natural selection. Inspired by biological evolution, theoretical physicist Lee Smolin came up with cosmological natural selection. It goes like this. The formation of black holes triggers the formation of a new universe. On the other side, in a new Big Bang, those daughter universes go on to expand and make their own black holes, and hence their own daughter universes. But in their formation, the fundamental constants of the daughter universes are shifted slightly and randomly from their parent. Mutations are introduced. Some of those shifts improve the daughter universes' ability to form new black holes. Those universes have an advantage in propagating their cosmic genetics, and so gradually the ensemble of all universes get better and better at making black holes, just as biological organisms with helpful mutations can get better at surviving and reproducing. Now, by happy chance, there's a correlation between making lots of black holes and making life. Both require stars. The universe that is better at making stars is better at making planetary systems, is better at making us. Seems fair enough, but is it any more than a cool story, bro? Let's take this apart and ask two questions. Is it plausible, and is it testable? First up, for any of this to make sense, black holes need to create universes. This is by far the most speculative part. In fact, we have no idea and only very tentative reason to think so. The idea originated with one of Lee Smolin's mentors, Bryce DeWitt, who postulated that when a black hole collapses, its mass doesn't all end up stuck in the central infinitely dense singularity, rather it sort of bounces. But unable to exit the event horizon of the black hole, it forms a new region of space-time, effectively creating a new universe. The details of how this happens is presumably buried in the as yet unknown theory of quantum gravity. There are various proposals for how such a bounce might happen, all of which are massively speculative, and perhaps we'll cover another time. John Archibald Wheeler expanded on the procreating black hole idea by suggesting that the fundamental constants of these new universes could be different to their parents. This seems plausible. If fundamental constants can change at all, then surely it's in the highest possible energy environments, which is exactly the end of a black hole collapse. Perhaps the configuration of the geometry of string theory's extra dimensions gets shifted. This would do the job. Inspired by this idea, Smolin added one thing. What if, when a universe reproduces, the constants aren't randomly reconfigured, but rather change only slightly, analogous to a small number of genetic mutations? If that were the case, a sort of evolution by natural selection would become inevitable as biological evolution. we have no good reason to believe any of this procreating universe stuff, and Lee Smolin has readily admitted that. The point is instead to ask, what if it's true? What are the consequences, and can we test them? The exponential nature of the proposed process means that the ensemble of all universes should very quickly be dominated by ones that are extremely good at making black holes. Any given universe may not be totally optimal because its constants varied randomly from its parent, in the same way that any given living organism isn't the paragon of its kind. So, there's a prediction. The fundamental constants that define black hole production should be close to optimal in a given universe, at least for a given mechanism for making black holes. In our modern universe, black holes are made when the most massive stars explode as supernovae. There are other ways to make black holes, and we'll come back to them. So, we should expect our universe to be optimized for producing as many of the most massive stars as possible. Well, is it? It's actually very hard to say, but it does seem like there's some fine tuning there. Stars are formed when giant clouds of gas collapse under their own gravity. But in order for that to happen, the gas needs to cool to just a few degrees above absolute zero, rather than the typical 200 Kelvin temperature of the typical interstellar nebula. That cooling is extremely slow if the gas only contains the hydrogen and helium produced in the Big Bang. Heavier elements and molecules allow clouds to cool and stars to form much more quickly. And of these, carbon monoxide is by far the most important coolant. In addition, gas needs to be shielded from the heating effect of other stars, and that seems to require the presence of tiny particles of ice and hydrocarbon dust. So without carbon, oxygen, water, and chemistry in general, far fewer stars and so far fewer black holes would form. And of course, these factors also seem to be essential for life. But what about other sources of black holes? Theoretical physicist and cosmologist Alexander Vilenkin proposed that if a universe lasts forever, then in the distant future, quantum fluctuations of that near vacuum will cause black holes to spontaneously appear. And given infinite time, these will eventually outnumber those produced by stars, or stellar black holes. If all of this is true, then most black holes would be produced by the biggest universes. More space means more chance for these quantum fluctuations. That favors lots of dark energy generating rapid expansion, and that is definitely not our universe. Lee Smolin has various arguments against this. For example, we don't know that our physics can really be extrapolated into the insanely long timescales required for these quantum fluctuations to happen. I would also add that even if Vilenkin's argument holds, there are no doubt different regions in the landscape of possible fundamental constants where different types of black hole are optimized. This would lead to multiple branches of the cosmic genetic tree, some of which correspond to producing lots of stellar black holes. And naturally, we find ourselves on one of those branches because those happen to be the ones that favor life. But, whoopsie, I just invoked the Anthropic Principle, which is exactly what we were trying to avoid with this whole idea. As speculative as all of this is, Smolin claims there's a concrete test for the idea. If cosmological natural selection is true, then the fundamental parameters favoring black hole production should be optimized completely independently to those that also favor the appearance of life. And he suggests there is one such parameter. But first, some background. When massive stars die, they actually mostly produce neutron stars, planet-sized balls of neutrons so dense that they teeter on the edge of collapsing into a black hole. Black holes only form when the neutron star is above a certain mass limit. Now, it may be that in the cores of the most massive neutron stars, some particles can convert into strange quarks. The resulting material is even denser than the original neutron star, and so brings the star closer to collapse. And the lower the mass of the strange quark, the easier it is to convert lighter particles into strange quarks. That in turn means less massive neutron stars would be able to collapse into black holes. Surely then, if universes evolve to maximize the number of black holes, then the strange quark mass should be optimized to make the cutoff between neutron stars and black holes as low as possible. Lee Smolin calculates that optimized cutoff at around 2 times the mass of the Sun. So, if this universe is optimized for black hole production, there should be no neutron stars more massive than 2 solar masses. And? Well, the most massive known neutron star is 2.17 solar masses discovered just this year. Now, perhaps the extra 0.17 can be factored into the uncertainties of the theory, or perhaps this is the falsification we were looking for. We await Smolin's comments on this. I'd like to add my own objection. Cosmological natural selection is meant to explain the fine-tuning in the fundamental constants, which appear to be either set by design or by extreme luck. It tries to avoid the Anthropic Principle by proposing a natural selection that favors black hole production, and it's just a happy coincidence that the same factors also favor life. But then, do we really gain anything? It just so happens that carbon and oxygen are good for both black hole production and organic molecules. But what if it was, I don't know, beryllium and boron that helped stars form, or other elements that were useless to life? If we causally disconnect the selection process for cosmic reproduction from the emergence of life, then it seems we still have to invoke a good lot of luck. Overall, cosmological natural selection is an appealing idea because it seeks a natural explanation for fine-tuning and one that parallels a known process in nature, biological evolution by natural selection. It also seems to give us predictions that we can try to test and falsify. And even though this idea is probably not true, it's really important to remember that speculative ideas like this are exactly how we probe the edges of science. No one of them is likely to be true, but they help us explore the vast space of all possible realities, where somewhere is hidden the true nature of our reality. Or, you know, our universe's mama might be a black hole, and we live in an endlessly evolving, proliferating space-time. Thank you to Brilliant.org for supporting PBS. If you want to understand astrophysics, you're going to need to have a solid understanding of relativity. Brilliant.org has a course on special relativity that includes interactive challenges and problems to solve. A hands-on approach can guide you through thinking strategies for challenging subjects like relativity. In this course, you'll begin by understanding Einstein's postulates and the Lorentz transformations, and as your knowledge advances, you'll learn how faster-than-light travel can break causality, and you'll even solve the famous twin paradox. To learn more about Brilliant, go to brilliant.org/spacetime. Hey everyone, thanks for watching. Your support each week is what makes this show possible. Now, totally optional, but one way to help out even more is to become a Patreon contributor. Even $2 a month gives you access to our Hoppin Discord channel. Thanks a ton if you've already joined us. And today, an extra special huge thanks to Big Bang supporter Craig Stanaha. Craig, as a small token of our appreciation, we've contacted our friends at the Large Hadron Collider. They're going to make you a black hole universe. Please email us with the configuration of fundamental constants you'd prefer, and we'll get it right out to you. Oddly enough, it's the same shipping company as our merch store, which you can check out at pbsspacetime.com. Last week, we talked about the Doomsday Argument, the unnerving idea that, statistically speaking, there aren't likely to be vastly more generations of humans ahead of us than there have been in the past. There were a lot of counter-arguments in the comments, perhaps good ones, because apparently we're still here. Many people came up with a similar objection. I'll quote Mr. Fantastic, who articulated it well. A human born 2 million years ago would come to the same conclusion that the end of the world is nigh, and so would a human born 2 million years from now. If we accept the reasoning of the Doomsday Argument, doesn't this just mean that everyone, for all of history, would come to the conclusion that we're all going to die sooner rather than later? This point is totally valid. In fact, a Cro-Magnon should reach the same conclusion and predict doom long before the 21st century, and obviously they would be wrong. But the doomsday argument isn't saying that every member of a species who employs this reasoning to predict their species' doom is going to be right. It says that the majority will be right if they predict that there will be a similar number of future generations as past generations. And by similar, I mean within a factor of a few. So ancient philosophers would have got it wrong, and perhaps will also eventually be wrong ancient philosophers to some very distant future generation. The point is that if any given individual assumes they're randomly sampled from all generations who thought about the doomsday argument, then chances are they didn't come near the start of their species. Now, the real problem with the doomsday argument isn't that users of it in the distant past would be wrong. Rather, it's not at all clear that it's reasonable to count ourselves as randomly selected from all of the users of the doomsday argument. Zahakiel highlights this trickiness in defining reference class with a great example. Step 1. Define reference class as Homo sapiens existing concurrently with the internet. Step 2. Observe that the internet has existed for approximately 30 years. Step 3. Assume self-sampling assumption makes sense and internet access is bell-curved over the duration of its existence or skewed towards late-phase access. Then, the internet is going to cease to exist sometime in the next 30 years. No one highlights another misuse of this idea. To quote, "What are the odds that I'm born as the Prince of France?" asked the Prince of France. Well, from the Prince of France's perspective, the answer to that question is a probability of 1. From everyone else's perspective, the answer is a probability of 0. And this really highlights the challenge in identifying our reference class for this sort of anthropic reasoning. Now, the Prince of France knows that he's the Prince of France, so from his perspective, the likelihood that he's the Prince of France is indeed 1. But imagine the Prince of France was raised secretly in a normal French family. He doesn't know who he is. All he knows is that someone in the population is the Prince of France. If you ask him for the probability that he's the Prince of France, he should probably say 1 in 33 million, or whatever the male population of France is. The point is that you need to take into account prior knowledge when you are defining your reference class. Nick Bostrom has another nice example of misusing the doomsday argument. Adam and Eve really want to, you know, hook up. Except they're afraid of God's wrath if Eve gets pregnant. The serpent comes along and explains that, according to the doomsday argument, the chances of Eve getting pregnant are nearly 0. After all, it's incredibly unlikely that Adam and Eve are the first 2 out of billions or trillions of future humans. Therefore, odds are they can have all the fun they want without risk of spawning an entire species. But an even better doomsday absurdity was from That Is Just Great, who says, "I was 30 seconds in when I realized this video is probably almost over." By that logic, this video is only halfway through.